Today, Fox Street, situated in the Johannesburg CBD, is an uninteresting one-way street, lined on either side by a mix of old stone and more modern building. In fact, the only buildings that could perhaps still be labeled as city landmarks in or near Fox Street is the once popular Coliseum Theatre, the now defunct Carlton Hotel, and the Carlton Centre, which was once the tallest building in the Southern Hemisphere. But almost 50 years ago, Fox Street was at the centre of arguably the most bizarre hostage drama in South African history. How's it? I'm Dr. Jacob Seynert. This is Stashy, and you're watching The Historian Stash. Monday morning, 28th of April, 1975, is crisp but sunny. Galia Miron is dropped off by her father at the Hershey building in Fox Street. She's on her way to a job interview at the Israeli Consulate on the 5th floor. She waves goodbye to her father and enters the building before taking the elevator to the Israeli Consulate. When she pushes the heavy steel door to enter, she immediately sees a man lying on the floor. Another, younger man in his mid-20s greets her, but then orders her to lie down, explaining that this is a security drill. Galia is not convinced and tells the man that she needs to go to the toilet. The man again orders her to lie down on the ground, this time more aggressively. This time, she obeys. The man is David Protter, a South African Jew born in Johannesburg to upper middle class parents. Apparently from a young age, Protter was troubled. He was described as a bully who took pleasure in tormenting his younger siblings. He was also obsessed with toy guns and real knives. As young adult, Protter joined the South African Defence Force, or the SADF, but that didn't last long. He volunteered to become a founding member of the Hunter Group, a precursor to the Special Forces 2 Reconnaissance Regiment, or 2 Recce. He claimed that he was appointed as a karate and unarmed combat instructor. But when his claims were checked by the SADF, it became apparent that he had merely applied for selection, but had failed to qualify. He never became an instructor. He also claimed that he had trained South African police or SAP reservists, again in karate and self-defense. This was also proven to be a fabrication. In fact, the SAP warned Protter to stop with his karate kali stories, because it was actually a criminal offense. He went to Israel in 1970 and joined the Israeli Defense Force, or the IDF, 2 years later. But he was discharged within 3 months for mental reasons. Shortly afterwards, he was arrested for impersonating an Israeli paratroop captain. He persisted in his impersonation and was rearrested several times, serving short prison times before being deported to South Africa. When the Yom Kippur War broke out in 1973, he was in South Africa and told his parents that he was returning to Israel to rejoin his unit to fight in the war against the Arabs. He disappeared for 2 weeks, and on his return, he told his parents that he had rejoined his unit by unorthodox means. His shoulder was heavily bandaged from a supposed war wound. but a later medical examination found no trace of such an injury. After this, he spent most of his time at home. Though this did not stop him from purchasing a 900cc Kawasaki motorcycle, which he equipped with a two-way radio set, gas masks, a first aid kit, and other equipment ready for any emergency or national disaster. He gave himself the grandiose title of Crisis Squad and wore a black motorcycle outfit and white motorbike helmet as his uniform. He would patrol the streets of Johannesburg in the event that the police needed his services. Unsurprisingly, the need for Crisis Squad never came. Somewhere along the line, Prater was offered a job as security guard at the Israeli Consulate by the then head of security, Bar Tov. His criminal record was apparently unknown to the Israeli Consulate because he had failed to disclose that he had once lived in Israel. He started out as a low-level security guard, working half days, and his duties were routine and of a low grade. After a while, he was tasked with searching passengers boarding aircraft of the Israeli National Airlines, El Al. Gradually, Prater became obsessed with the fact that the consulate security was poor. He was convinced that it was his task to expose the holes within the system. So, for about a year, he began to secretly plan how to go about testing the security. His first idea was to hijack an El Al aircraft. Another was to kidnap an Israeli VIP. Eventually, he settled on a plan to take over the Israeli consulate in Johannesburg. Then in October 1974, Bartov found out that Prater had lived in Israel and confronted him about why he did not disclose it in his application. Prater actually admitted to lying, to which Bar responded that he would run a check with authorities in Israel. However, 2 weeks later, for unknown reasons, Bar informed Prater that he could keep his job despite his lies. In November 1974, Bartov was transferred and Major Giora Raviv was appointed Chief of Security in his place. In contrast to Prater, Giora had enjoyed a distinguished career as a paratrooper in the Israeli army. He was among the first to enter Jerusalem's Old City during the 1967 Six-Day War. He was on holiday with his wife Marit in Acapulco, Mexico, when the Yom Kippur War broke out. Determined not to let his unit down, he rushed to the airport and used his influence to get a seat on an El Al flight. He arrived in Israel in time to take command of his unit in the big push across the Suez Canal to the West Bank. The code word chosen to signal his tactical headquarters as soon as his unit landed on the West Bank was Acapulco. Tension between Giora and Prater developed almost immediately. Prater complained about the poor security at the consulate to visiting Israeli security inspectors, who allegedly told him that they would think about his complaints and let him know. He claimed that he was told that he would be given the opportunity to go to Israel to present his ideas. Needless to say, the Israeli authorities knew nothing about this. In February 1975, 2 months before the siege, Prater went to see a Johannesburg paging company on the false premise that he was acting on behalf of the Israeli embassy. At his request, the company worked out special radio security for the paging system, which only he had access to. With this, Prater was able to maintain 24-hour contact with the consulate. He hired two walkie-talkie radios, each with a different wavelength. Meanwhile, he had arranged for his 19-year-old brother, Charles, to also be employed as a part-time security guard at the consulate. Charles's primary duty was to stand outside the consulate's main security doors, checking arrivals. In this way, he became a useful component in his brother's plan. At 10 past 8 a.m. on the 28th of April 1975, Giora is dropped off at the Hershey building by Marit, who is 8 months pregnant. He walks into the building and takes the elevator up to the consulate. He's greeted by Charles Prater at the consulate entrance, and Charles opens the door for him. As Giora enters, he sees David Prater, armed with a .45 revolver, a .22 pistol, and an Uzi submachine gun. Giora demands to know what's going on. Prater informs him that he's carrying out an exercise. When Giora asks who had given him such instructions, Prater says they've come directly from Jerusalem. Unsurprisingly, as chief of security, Giora does not accept this at all. Being unarmed, Giora realizes that the only way to disarm Prater is to charge at him and physically overpower him. Desperately, Giora lunges at Prater and a struggle ensues. Sensing that his delusion might come to a premature end, Prater panics and reaches for one of his firearms and fires. He shoots Giora 3 times, one shot in the back, killing him. At 8:30 a.m., Ari Bustan, the Israeli Consul General in Johannesburg, arrives at the consulate and is also greeted by Charles, who opens the door for him. Once inside, David Prater tells him that a security exercise is being conducted and escorts Bustan to a back room where another consulate employee, Yochai Shaked, is tied up, lying on the floor. At 10:45 a.m., Maurice Kaplan, a South African-born architect visiting from Israel, arrives at the consulate to have papers signed by Vice Consul Shemi Tsu. But when he gets to the entrance, Charles informs Maurice that he cannot enter. Maurice demands to see Tsu as arranged. David Prater eventually allows the captured Vice Consul to go and see Kaplan, who is waiting impatiently outside the entrance. The moment he's out of the front door, Tsur shouts in Hebrew that the consulate has been hijacked and that everyone should get out of the building immediately. Prater sees people running towards the stairs and the elevator on the closed circuit television monitor and orders Charles to catch and restrain Tsur and bring him back into the consulate. Charles chases after Tsur, who runs towards the Varig Brazilian Airways offices situated on the ground floor. Charles eventually catches up with him and grabs him. He then handcuffs Tsur before dragging him into the Airways offices. By that time, Maurice also finds himself on the ground floor and sees Tsur handcuffed to a Brazilian man. When Charles wants to take them both upstairs, the Brazilian, according to Maurice, refused to budge. So Charles releases him and turns towards Maurice, asking him if he wanted to be handcuffed to Tsur. Unsurprisingly, Maurice decides against being taken hostage. Tsur then begs Maurice to phone the police. He shouts once more, "Our officers are being hijacked," before being dragged away by Charles by the scruff of the neck. Once Charles and Tsur return to inside the consulate, Prater shoves Tsur back into the room where all the hostages are being kept. At mid-morning, Murit arrives at the consulate to see Giora. When she gets there, Prater tells her not to enter as there's an emergency in progress and her husband has left for Pretoria. Murit leaves but returns an hour later, demanding that Charles let her in. She's once again told to leave, but she refuses. Eventually, the door is reluctantly opened for her. Once inside, she sees Prater wearing a camouflage battle jacket and carrying an Uzi and 2 handguns in his belt. She asks where her husband is, but Prater tries to persuade her to leave. She again refuses, but a while later she asks if she could go to the bathroom on the landing between the 4th and the 5th floors. Prater allows her to go and gives the Vice Consul's wife permission to accompany her. Once there, Mrs. Tsu reveals to Marit that Prater has murdered her husband. When they get back to the consulate, Marit calmly asks Prater if she may be allowed to leave without revealing her newfound knowledge. Prater agrees and she is released. Inexplicably, Marit does not contact the police. By this time, the Prater brothers have managed to capture 17 hostages, most of them consulate employees. But there are also children of employees who have accompanied their parents to work as there is no school. Once captured, each hostage is shown an explosive device which later turn out to be fake. Prata further intimidates them by forcing them to view the body of the slain major. He also makes them crawl whenever they need to move around the consulate, seemingly so that they don't get an opportunity to jump him. By the time the 18th and last hostage, the chief security officer for LL in Johannesburg, is captured, the SAP is still not aware of the hostage situation in Fox Street. However, a message had already been sent to the Israeli embassy in Pretoria that something was not right at the consulate. A similar message was sent to Jerusalem, and then finally to the SAP in Pretoria. At 11:45 a.m., two policemen arrive and go up to the fifth floor to find Charles Prata sitting at his desk. He tells the two policemen that everything is fine. The policemen leave and return to their normal routine. At 12:30 p.m., Major General Mike Geldenhuys, commander of the SAP security branch, is phoned by the Israeli ambassador, Dr. Yatshik Una, who requests that the SAP check the building one more time. Geldenhuys immediately contacts the security police at John Foster Square and orders a contingent to go to Fox Street. While en route, Lieutenant Colonel C.D. Hubert attempts to phone the consulate using the radio, but he is unsuccessful. After finding out that Prata had hired two walkie-talkies on behalf of the embassy, Hubert phones the paging company, who then puts him through via the frequency of the walkie-talkie. Moments later, Charles Prata contacts the paging company, stating that the consulate has been seized. At the same time, David Prata also calls the paging company and gives the prearranged code word, indicating that the consulate is being attacked. Suddenly, Prata shouts over the radio that the consulate has been taken over by six terrorists, three Japanese and three Lebanese. He then cuts the transmission and all attempts to contact him again fail. What happens next defies logic and explanation. Half a block away is the massive Garlicks and Carlton Center, which occupies a large block bounded by Commissioner, Kreis, Main and Von Wilk streets. By lunchtime, the streets surrounding the consulate are crowded with shoppers and those wishing to get a quick lunch at the Carlton Hotel. Then, at around 1:15 p.m, all hell breaks loose. A staccato of automatic weapon fire and bullets cut into the crowds on the streets. People start to drop to the ground in agony as the bullets hit them. One witness rushes to the seventh floor of the building he's in and runs out onto the roof garden just in time to see how three people are shot on the street below. Members of the Lonro group of companies with offices on the 11th floor of the Trust Bank Center run to the windows after hearing the gunfire and watch in disbelief as puffs of smoke erupt from the Hershey building below them, with bullets being fired into Von Brandes Street. A man, wounded at the intersection of Fox and Von Brandes Streets, is dragged to shelter until an ambulance is able to get to him. Sonja Brandt was taking a lunchtime stroll down Fox Street when she sees a woman in front of her fall suddenly to the ground. I thought she'd had a heart attack or something. Then I saw blood spurting from her neck. I bent over to see if I could help her. Some men picked her up. Then I heard a machine gun going off. The man behind me fell down. He'd been shot in the stomach and was bleeding. Another man next to me was hit in the foot. It was just a mess. Many of the initial victims are those walking down Fox Street next to the rear wall of the Colosseum Theatre. David Feldman witnessed the chaos that unfolded there. They were squashing each other against the wall while the terrorists fired at them. People on all sides were screaming as panic spread. They started running in all directions. Among the people lying and bleeding, I saw one little boy who had been hit in the leg. Filemon Mujane escapes death when a bullet grazes the back of his neck. But others are not as lucky. Petrus de Plooy had been shopping for a car cover at the shopping center. His curiosity gets the better of him when he sees a crowd gathering in Von Willich Street, and so he wanders over to see what's happening. A stray bullet pierces his lung and hits his spine. As a result, he's left paralyzed for life. The police eventually arrive and commence a sporadic return fire. This increases as more police officers get into position. Soon, ambulances arrive, but they cannot get to the wounded because the roads are blocked by thousands of curious onlookers. Finally, the area is cordoned off with police roadblocks and the onlookers are told to get away. The ambulances force their way through and make it to the wounded. The casualty wing of Johannesburg General Hospital is a scene of utter chaos. The wounded are initially placed on trolleys, but when they run out of trolleys, they are placed on the hospital floor. At least 40 people are wounded, some critically. But incredibly, no one is killed. After about half an hour, the shooting quietens down, other than an occasional shot from a policeman echoing down the street, or a rattle of automatic gunfire from the consulate window. During these early stages of the gunfire exchange, two hostages, Evelyn Dakin and Edwin Molopo, are shot in the legs. Galia Miron, one of the first to be taken hostage, was lying on the floor, afraid that the return fire from the police would kill them. She writes, "I was like part of the wall, because all the wounded were hit by a shooting of the South Africans, who fired from below in an attempt to hit him." However, her fear for the police is completely overshadowed by the fear she has for her captor. She remembers, "The scariest moment was when he asked the children and some of the women to load the weapons with clips. I am so bad at technical things that my hands shook and I was scared that I would never be able to insert the clip." At this point, it's been generally accepted, in view of the radio call made by Protter, as well as the fire from multiple directions within the consulate, that the police are facing a terrorist cell. It's most likely, given Protter's description, that these terrorists are part of the infamous Japanese Red Army, or Rengo Sekugun, fanatical terrorists linked to the Black September faction of the Palestinian Liberation Army, responsible for the Lot Airport massacre in 1970. The orders of the South African Prime Minister, John Vorster, are clear and concise to the men on the ground at Fox Street. Under no circumstances are the terrorists allowed to leave the building to go anywhere. If any or all of the hostages are to be sacrificed, it would be considered necessary collateral damage. These sentiments are shared by the Israeli government. At one point, the authorities even consider blowing up the Hershey building with all the hostages inside. The Fox Street siege has now reached a tipping point.